dramatic scenes inside Armenia's National Assembly, two nations at war on the battlefield and with plastic bottles in parliament. This was moments after a fragile deal to end fighting between Armenia and Azerbaijan was signed. Meanwhile, here at home, a slightly more functional administration, determined to win an increasingly losing argument, refusing to face defeat, and at all costs to our democracy. Republican leaders fall in line with the president as he challenges the legality of the election results despite proof. The Secretary of State enabling the president's denial, promising a, quote, smooth transition to a second Trump administration, just as nearly all the world's leaders, with the exception of Russia and North Korea's, have congratulated Biden. Turbulent transition. President-elect Joe Biden calls President Trump's refusal to concede, quote, an embarrassment, and calls the Republican Supreme Court challenge to Obamacare in the middle of a pandemic simply cruel and needlessly divisive. 21 million Americans' health care at risk. The Supreme Court, including its newest justice, Amy Coney Barrett, hearing arguments about the Affordable Care Act, what Chief Justice John Roberts said Congress should have already done, and the real people whose lives hang in the balance.
I think it's that coming to the decision of our finances versus his care.
COVID cases on the rise now in all 50 states, 1 week straight of more than 100,000 new cases each day. El Paso has now emerged as the new epicenter of the pandemic. Refrigerated trucks help morgues handle the overflow of bodies, plus the latest on Pfizer's vaccine and how it plans to roll out millions of doses. Russian relations. Look at the challenges facing the Biden administration. Our exclusive interview with a former Marine locked inside a Russian jail. And is this the future of travel? Energy efficient and almost as fast as a commercial jet.
3, 2, 1, launch.
Tonight, the unveiling of Virgin's Hyperloop. Good evening, everyone. I'm Lindsay Davis. Thanks so much for streaming with us. 1,784 votes. That's how many more votes George W. Bush had over Al Gore in the state of Florida after the first unofficial count was completed following Election Day in 2000. After weeks of recounts and contentious court fights all the way up to the Supreme Court, Bush, with a slim margin of just 537 votes, became the president-elect. Now, let's be clear, 2020 is not 2000. Tonight, 1 week after election night, here's where the race stands for the White House. Joe Biden leads President Trump by more than 4.5 million in the popular vote and holds 279 electoral votes, enough to make him the president-elect. But the Trump campaign has contested the vote with failed legal challenges in at least four states. In Georgia, Biden leads Trump by more than 12,000 votes. In Nevada, Biden leads Trump by more than 36,000 votes. In Pennsylvania, Biden leads Trump by more than 47,000 votes. And in Michigan, Biden leads Trump by more than 148,000 votes. Now, President Trump claims fraud in voting and ballot counting is giving the former vice president the White House, but he's yet to produce evidence. And a few allegations that have been raised have already been dismissed by the courts. But despite that, the Republican establishment continues to stand by the president not conceding the election, including comments today by the Secretary of State that there would be, quote, smooth transition to a second Trump administration. The president's refusal to concede drew a rebuke from President-elect Joe Biden today, who called it an embarrassment. And that's where we begin tonight with ABC's Mary Bruce.
Today, President-elect Joe Biden reassuring the American people that he's forging ahead with his transition, even though the White House isn't cooperating and President Trump won't admit he lost.
Sir, what do you say to the Americans that are anxious over the fact that President Trump has yet to concede and what that might mean for the country?
Well, I just think it's an embarrassment, quite frankly. The only thing that, how can I say this tactfully? I think it will not help the president's legacy.
The president has been holed up in the White House since Saturday, only venturing out to his golf clubs, refusing to accept the reality that he's been defeated. Today on Twitter, still insisting, we will win. He's filed a host of long-shot legal challenges, but has yet to provide a shred of evidence of any widespread fraud. But he is getting help from his Attorney General Bill Barr, who authorized the Justice Department to pursue substantial allegations of voting and vote tabulation irregularities. Even as Barr admits, none have actually emerged. Trump is also getting backup from Senate Republicans.
Have you congratulated Vice President Biden yet?
No.
Why not?
Vice President Mike Pence on the Hill today, also avoiding questions.
Mr. Vice President, is it time to concede? Is there really any evidence of fraud?
But the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, did answer questions and reinforced Trump's false claims.
Is the State Department currently preparing to engage with the Biden transition team? And if not, at what point does a delay hamper a smooth transition or pose a risk to national security?
There will be a smooth transition to a second Trump administration.
That message from America's top diplomat is not being heard by world leaders. Today, one after another, they called to congratulate Biden. The UK's Boris Johnson, Germany's Angela Merkel, and French President Emmanuel Macron.
I wanted really to congratulate you and congratulate Kamala Harris for this election.
Biden's message to them.
I'm letting them know that America's back. We're going to be back in the game. It's not American alone.
So we asked the president-elect his message for the president.
If he is watching right now, what would you say to him?
Mr. President, look forward to speaking with you.
What options are you considering? How will you move ahead if the president continues to refuse to concede?
We're going to do exactly what we'd be doing if he had conceded and said we've won, which we have. And so there's nothing really changing.
But not ruling out legal action?
No, I don't see a need for legal action. Quite frankly. So far, there is no evidence of any of the assertions made by the president or Secretary of State Pompeo. Secretary of State Pompeo.
Mary Bruce joins us now. And Mary, President-elect Biden seems to really be brushing off any concerns about the president not conceding the race. But is there any concern inside his team that this delay could undermine his victory and his ability to unite the country as he's pledged to do?
I think there is some concern within the Biden campaign that the narrative that the president and his team is pushing could be effective in some areas. A concern, as they put it, that he may be able to create a cloud of uncertainty. They are absolutely confident that they are going to win this, that they have won this, that Joe Biden is the president-elect. And Joe Biden is definitely trying to project calm, trying to lower the temperature amid all of this uncertainty, saying that despite the fact that the president is refusing to concede, he doesn't see anything that is standing in the way of their transition, making it very clear they are forging ahead.
And how's the Biden campaign responding to the legal challenges that the Trump campaign has brought forward so far?
They are absolutely confident that they stand on very solid legal ground. And of course, the president and his team have yet to put forth even a shred of evidence to back up their claims of widespread voter fraud. And we have seen so far their legal challenges facing some very real hurdles. The Biden team saying in a statement that American democracy is stronger than any clumsy and cynical partisan political scheme. They feel that they are in a good position, Lindsay.
Okay, Mary Bruce, thanks so much. One day after firing Defense Secretary Mark Esper, President Trump continued shaking things up in his administration today, removing three other top Pentagon officials. ABC's Martha Raddatz is here. So, Martha, who are the officials that have now been forced out?
You know, you're not going to recognize the names of these officials. They are not familiar names to people, but the jobs they held are key. Chief of staff to the Secretary of Defense, head of intelligence and security, head of policy. And the biggest thing about these are their replacements. They're very controversial, and that includes a retired brigadier general whose nomination for a Pentagon job this summer was withdrawn because of Islamophobic tweets. He also called President Obama a terrorist leader. And of course, this does follow that very abrupt firing of Secretary Mark Esper yesterday. Within 1 hour after the president tweeted that he was firing him, Chris Miller, his replacement, was climbing the steps of the Pentagon. Chris Miller's a former special operations soldier. He'd been director of the Counterterrorism Center, but really only for a couple of months. And before that, he was just a mid-level person at the Pentagon.
And Martha, you've covered the Pentagon for years. How unprecedented is it to see something like this, especially during a transition from an outgoing administration? And is there any concern that it puts national security at risk?
You know, Lindsay, I certainly can't remember anything like this from any president. To make these kind of changes during a transition. Look, we knew Mark Esper was in trouble because he publicly went against the president, saying he did not think active duty troops should be used against protesters. He said that in June. So he was definitely not on the good guy list for President Trump. But to do it so suddenly and to have his replacement and then make all these other changes in the Pentagon really has people concerned inside the Pentagon, outside the Pentagon, about why exactly he did this. Does he want to now federalize troops if there's some sort of civil unrest? Or is he planning some kind of military operation? They just don't know. But as you said, Lindsay, this is unprecedented.
Lots of uncertainty there. Martha Raddatz, thanks so much. More than 165,000 new cases of coronavirus in the U.S. have been diagnosed in just the past 24 hours, making it more than 10 million cases since the outbreak began. At least 239,306 lives have been lost in this country. But recent news about vaccine development has given hope to a country and a world besieged by this virus. Our Matt Gutman has the latest.
Tonight, the country with those grim firsts, 165,000 daily COVID cases and rising cases in all 50 states. And now the nation on the verge of more COVID patients hospitalized than ever before.
There are 154 bodies in there and out there.
And perhaps nowhere is the toll more apparent than El Paso, Texas. County Judge Ricardo Samaniego leading us into his hometown's heartbreak.
You think that you have two friends who died who might be in one of these trucks?
One for sure, I think, but I have no clue.
The state shipping in 10 trucks.
And yet another mobile morgue truck pulling in. There are more of them on the way here.
COVID cases soaring here. Every hospital in the area using those blue surge tents.
Because our testing is so inadequate and we're missing so many people, my best guess is that between 300,000 and 400,000 Americans are getting infected every day. So it's unfortunately much worse than it even appears.
Across the country, frontline workers are pleading with the public.
If I can do CPR on a person that's dying because of COVID while I wear a mask, you can probably wear a mask when you walk around a store.
Tonight, hope resting on that vaccine. If Pfizer gets the green light for its vaccine, 20 million doses could be produced every month.
We have anticipated that we will have enough vaccine by the end of December to have vaccinated our most vulnerable citizens in nursing homes and otherwise, and by the end of January, enough for all healthcare workers and first responders.
After that, essential workers like teachers, law enforcement, and food plant workers. Then adults with high-risk conditions and those over 65. The rest of Americans could get access to the vaccine at the end of March at the earliest. But the government faces unprecedented logistical hurdles trying to move millions of doses of a vaccine that needs to be stored at minus 94 degrees from these big freezers at Pfizer into small containers packed with dry ice shipped around the country by FedEx and UPS.
We not only have the track of the location, but also we track the temperature, which is a way of ensuring that the vaccine that is actually finally given to the person being vaccinated is still good.
Carefully monitoring those vaccines. Matt Gutman joins us now. And Matt, Dr. Fauci has weighed in at this point on when we expect most Americans will get the vaccine, as well as the FDA approving a new antibody treatment.
Right, so two separate things. First, Dr. Fauci hopes that most Americans will be able to get the vaccine by late April. He says that's a guesstimate. Now, the antibody treatment approved by the FDA is very specific. It's designed for people 65 or over with underlying health conditions and who only have mild or moderate symptoms. People are not yet in the hospital. The idea is to try to keep them out of the hospital. But as with the vaccine, there's serious logistical issues here. Initially, supply will be limited, and administering it, because it's an IV, is going to be very tricky for medical practitioners, Lindsay.
And Matt, let's also talk about El Paso. You were there not long ago, and the situation there has only gotten worse since you returned. What are you hearing from officials about how they expect to pull themselves out of the crisis?
That's a really good question. So the judge here has ordered a lockdown in the city. It's not being observed partly because of internal politics in the state of Texas. That's too complicated right now, but basically there is a divide between people who say, let's shut everything down, give a break, everybody wear masks, let's let the virus subside and the escalating, exploding number of cases reduced for a while, and other people are saying, well, we need to keep businesses open. So that's that. Last time we were here, Lindsay, there was talk of the possible need for morgue trucks, those refrigerator trucks we showed you in the piece, but they hadn't arrived. And, you know, there are, I guess, six on the ground today. More are coming. And the county judge told me that if the prison rate continues and if there isn't a lockdown, they're going to need more of them. There are literally bodies piling up in the morgue here in the medical examiner's office in El Paso. Lindsay.
Also disconcerting there. Matt, thanks for that.
Yeah.
And now to the Supreme Court showdown over the fate of the Affordable Care Act, popularly known as Obamacare. Health care for millions is now on the line in the middle of a pandemic. And there's a spotlight on that controversial mandate that requires everyone to have insurance. What we heard today from two key conservative justices. ABC's Terry Moran gives us the debrief.
Today, in their own words, we heard from the justices of the Supreme Court on the fate of the Affordable Care Act, along with its guaranteed protections for millions of Americans with pre-existing conditions. The Trump administration and several Republican-led states argued that the individual mandate at the heart of the ACA, requiring that all Americans have health insurance, should be struck down as unconstitutional and the whole law thrown out with it. But even some conservative justices weren't buying it, saying they could strike down just a mandate, leaving the rest of the law in place. Justice Brett Kavanaugh.
It does seem fairly clear that the proper remedy would be to sever the mandate provision and leave the rest of the act in place, the provisions regarding pre-existing conditions and the rest.
Chief Justice John Roberts agreed, noting sharply that Republicans in Congress had the chance to repeal the whole act, but didn't.
I think frankly, that they wanted the court to do that, but that's not our job.
President-elect Joe Biden blasting the Trump administration as cruel for putting health care for 21 million Americans on the line as the coronavirus pandemic crests in a third deadly wave across the country.
The consequence of the Trump administration's argument are not academic or an abstraction. For many Americans, they're a matter of life and death in a literal sense.
We're getting Andrew's day started here with his morning feed.
In Ohio, Christine Callahan's 13-year-old son, Andrew, has an undiagnosed genetic condition. She worries how they could afford his medical bills, $7,000 a month, without the ACA.
I think it's that coming to the decision of our finances versus his care.
Our thanks to Terry Moran for that. We're joined now by ABC's Devin Dwyer, who covers the Supreme Court for us. And Devin, we heard from that family in your report for us yesterday. Such a difficult time for them and so many. Of course, Devin, you heard the more than 2 hours of arguments today. So what's the bottom line here? Can those families who are depending on this law breathe a sigh of relief tonight?
Well, you can never predict for certain, Lindsay, based on the oral argument, just how the court is going to go, but it sure does look like the Affordable Care Act is here to stay. And that is a huge relief for those families you were talking about, people relying on the pre-existing conditions, the insurance subsidies and the like. Even if the court concludes that the individual insurance mandate is unconstitutional, we saw 5 votes today, including Chief Justice Roberts and Kavanaugh, likely votes to keep the rest of the law in place. So that's good news for supporters of Obamacare.
And what role will the new Justice Amy Coney Barrett play in all this? Her views on Obamacare, after all, were front and center in her confirmation last month.
Yeah, they sure were. And remember, President Trump appointed Amy Coney Barrett to the Supreme Court with the express goal of killing the law. She was front and center today. She had been, of course, skeptical of the Affordable Care Act when she was in academia and the individual mandate. That skepticism was on full display today. She suggested that the mandate is still unconstitutional. She also cast doubt on whether it could be severed from the law. So she'll be closely watched in all of this, Lindsay, but it is very clear that her vote will not be a decisive one.
And is there anything the incoming president-elect Biden or the new Congress could do to protect and improve the ACA?
Yeah, you know, even before the court hands down its decision, the new Congress, President-elect Biden, could come together and try to neutralize this case. They could try to take the individual mandate officially off the books. They could also try to put the tax, the penalty, back into the law, which would, you know, negate all of these arguments. Because this town is so divided, that's a little bit unlikely. But we have seen President-elect Biden make a centerpiece of his campaign improving Obamacare. Obamacare. He wants to bolster those subsidies for middle-class families. Also has talked about a public option to compete with private plans. All of those things, though, Lindsay, at least the results that we've seen so far from last Tuesday suggest Republicans will need to get on board. So it's going to be a bit of a debate on health care once Biden takes office.
And when can we expect the court to hand down its decision?
Well, the justices are going to officially vote on this case on Friday. They'll then write their opinions, and we do expect those to come down sometime early next year, certainly before the end of June 2021, Lindsay.
Devin Dwyer, thanks so much.
Thanks, Lindsay.
And when we come back, the stage is set for a bitter fight for control in the Senate in the state of Georgia. How one side of the political divide plans to organize. How did one of the most influential Catholic Church leaders in America rise to power despite repeated accusations of sexual abuse? We'll break down the new bombshell revelations from the Vatican report. But up next, the former Marine locked inside a Russian jail speaks exclusively with us. How his case is one of several challenges that could strain U.S.-Russian relations during the Biden administration.
The most powerful stories of our time, anytime. Nightline.
Your mom said, comb your hair. Your dad told you, smarten up. Your dog is judging you right now. And your best friend just called you crazy. We all need someone who'll pull no punches and give it to us straight. Now, imagine getting your news like that. No bull, no spin, just give it to me straight. Straightforward news, straight to the heart of the story. ABC News, straightforward.
We move up to the vehicle. He detonates a bomb.
The heroes who stopped the killer, who held the city of Austin hostage for 19 days.
It's a tripwire.
All hands on deck.
The clues, the Home Depot video, that truck, and the agent who connected the dots.
It was exactly the vehicle that we were looking for.
Inside the investigation.
Vans made contact.
The takedown of the bomber. Now streaming on Hulu.
I know what happened. And I'm not guilty.
Why the fascination with criminal trials? And figure out what's really out there.
Now, with so much on the line, more Americans are turning to David Muir and ABC's World News Tonight than any other show. Thank you for making ABC's World News Tonight with David Muir the most watched show on all of television. COVID-19. What can you do to help protect yourself? Where can you get your questions answered? The new daily podcast from ABC News with Dr. Jennifer Ashton and a team of experts. Listen free on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts.
As we mentioned earlier, across the globe, foreign leaders reached out to President-elect Joe Biden offering their congratulations. But one leader who did not, Russia's Vladimir Putin. The Kremlin says that they will wait for the official results. Now, that's a far different approach than their actions 4 years ago when President Trump won his election. But 4 years after Russia tried to influence our election, U.S.-Russia relations remain strained. The arrest of at least two former U.S. service members, including Paul Whelan, who spoke with us tonight, have only made matters worse. Patrick Reval has this report.
For almost 2 years, we've heard little from Paul Whelan, the former U.S. Marine held in Russia as a spy, but whose family and U.S. officials say was a tourist grabbed as a political hostage. Kept in pretrial detention in Moscow for 18 months, Whelan's trial was held almost entirely behind closed doors.
This is simply a dog and pony show for the media. They're not doing anything at all.
In June, Whelan was sentenced to 16 years in a prison camp. Journalists only able to grab snatched comments from him.
Paul, I am from ABC News. Do you want to say something?
Sure, no, wait, wait,
I don't think they want me to say anything.
Now settled there, for the first time, ABC has spoken with Whelan from the camp. The first time a journalist has been able to talk extensively with him.
The place is very, very old. It's very grim, quite dilapidated, but we're in, barracks. There's probably 50 to 60 of us in the building, so we kind of live on top of each other. It's quite crowded.
The camp is a former gulag in Mordovia, located about 300 miles from Moscow. Like other inmates, Whelan works 8 hours a day making clothes.
They've actually been quite welcoming. You know, they all laughed when I got here and said if the FSB had sent someone to my hotel room, it was obviously a trap.
He says he was in Moscow for a friend's wedding when he was detained by Russian intelligence.
I mean, the whole thing was just like you see it on TV, you know, with the black masks. You know, they had a guy videotaping it. First, I wasn't sure if it was real or not. I didn't know if friends of mine would have set up a gag or not. It obviously became, you know, quite real.
The FSB accused Whelan of receiving a flash drive with classified material on it. Whelan says he was framed by his longtime Russian friend, who he accuses of collaborating with the FSB to set him up.
On the, you know, the day in question, he came over unannounced. I'm taking a shower, trying to get ready to go to this wedding dinner. And, you know, 10 minutes after he gets there, you know, his friends come through the door and say, I'm a spy.
Since Whelan's arrest, a second ex-Marine, 26-year-old Trevor Reed, was sentenced to 9 years in a Russian jail in another dubious trial. American officials have said they believe Russia would like to trade Whelan and Reed for Russians held in the U.S.
So what we're seeing with Mr. Whelan and with others that have been detained without probable cause in Russia is a negotiating tool. These are pawns. These people are caught up in the tit-for-tat between the two intelligence services, and unfortunately somebody has to pay the price.
Russian officials have floated the idea of a trade for two men in particular. Victor Boot, an arms dealer serving a 25-year sentence in the U.S. on a terrorism charge, and Konstantin Yaroshenko, a pilot convicted of drug smuggling.
The night I was arrested, they asked me if I knew who those two people were.
The jailed Americans' cases underline the challenges that President-elect Joe Biden will face in dealing with Russia. Vladimir Putin has still yet to congratulate Biden days after the election was called by the U.S. media.
The relationship between the U.S. and Russia will always vary between cold and colder. It's in Mr. Putin's interest to keep tensions high with the U.S. because it builds domestic political favor, and it also keeps the people distracted from the kinds of things that are going on in Russia.
During a town hall meeting, the president-elect vowed to maintain a tough stance on Russia.
Attempting to interfere with our election is a violation of our sovereignty. And if it's done again, which it appears to be being done, there'll be a price to pay. There'll be a price to pay. And Putin knows the reason he doesn't want me as president. He knows me, and he knows I mean it. I don't mean war, but they'll pay a price.
But to get home, these veterans need at least a crack in the ice in Russian relations. Whelan's family tells us there are currently no negotiations underway for his release. A new presidency could be a moment that makes that easier. But the silence from the Kremlin on Biden's election is not a promising sign for future relations. Patrick Reval in Moscow for ABC News Live.
Our thanks to Patrick for that. And still ahead here on Prime, the ceasefire between Armenia and Azerbaijan and the growing outrage over the deal. The iceberg the size of Delaware on a collision course for an island, we'll explain. And we spoke about the Supreme Court battle over Obamacare earlier, but we'll take a closer look at the impact by the numbers. But first, our tweet of the day. Happy 51st birthday to Sesame Street.
In times like these, the news-making events happen here. ABC News.
President Trump meeting face-to-face with one of the world's most brutal dictators, Kim Jong-un.
The president.
Do you trust him?
I do trust him, yeah. I think he trusts me, and I trust him.
Ivanka Trump.
I have to ask you about your emails. Your father had taken Hillary Clinton to task for this.
There just is no equivalency.
So the idea of lock her up doesn't apply to you?
No.
Comey.
How strange is it for you to sit here and compare the president to a mob boss?
Very strange.
Michelle Obama.
What do you wish you could tell your pre-White House self?
Whew. Melania Trump.
Do you think there's still people there that he can't trust?
Yes.
Still working now?
Yes.
Michael Cohen.
So he's still lying?
Yes.
It's a big statement.
And now, in a year with so much on the line, we're right there.
Good evening tonight from Washington, a very busy news night.
America's number one news source, ABC News, straightforward.
Welcome back, everyone. We turn again to health care and the Affordable Care Act, also known as Obamacare. And we take a look now by the numbers at what's at stake as the Supreme Court decides the law's fate. More than 21 million Americans could lose health insurance if the ACA is entirely repealed, which would increase the number of those who are uninsured by nearly 70% and could leave almost 54 million people, or 27% of all adults under 65, uninsurable because they have pre-existing conditions. That's according to the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, and that's before accounting for COVID-19. After Obamacare was enacted, the number of uninsured non-elderly Americans declined by 20 million, dropping to a historic low in 2016. But there's been a recent uptick in uninsured Americans. 28.9 million non-elderly Americans had no insurance at all in 2019. That's a million more than the year before. Critics of Obamacare point to higher premiums and deductibles for those with insurance. For example, the average premium for a mid-level plan for a 40-year-old climbed to $462 a month in 2020 from $273 in 2014, according to the Kaiser Family Foundation. And now 18 Republican-led states and two individuals are bringing this latest ACA challenge to the Supreme Court. This is the third major challenge since it was enacted in 2010. And we still have lots to get to here on Prime. The election was just a week ago, but organizers are already gearing up for the hotly contested dual runoffs in Georgia. We'll speak with a woman credited with getting tens of thousands registered to vote. Imagine travel that used to take hours taking place in just minutes. We take a closer look at Hyperloop technology and how the country music community has stepped up during the pandemic. But first, a look at our top trending stories on ABCnews.com.
This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live, the 24/7 streaming news source from ABC News. Breaking news, live events, streaming nonstop. Original breakthrough storytelling from ABC News, National Geographic, ESPN. And it's all designed differently for you to stream straight to any screen whenever you want.
ABC News Live.
Streaming everywhere, right to you.
ABC News Live. It's that easy to go there.
The Americans here on the ground and the Iraqis.
18,000 tons. Matatas.
Ismail? David.
Over ground zero from Hurricane Michael.
You can see just home after home.
David, good to meet you.
This was your view.
My favorite view.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And now we turn to an explosive new report out of the Vatican. One of the oldest religious institutions in the world continues to be plagued by evidence of sexual abuse and pedophilia. But for the first time, the Vatican is placing the blame on a saint, Saint John Paul II. The report comes the Pope of nearly three decades knew of the allegations against former Washington Cardinal McCarrick, yet promoted him anyway. Our Ian Pannell joins us with the latest.
Tonight, an explosive Vatican report revealing Pope John Paul II knew about extensive sexual abuse allegations regarding adults and minors against Theodore McCarrick, but still promoted him to Archbishop and then Cardinal. McCarrick, at one time one of the most powerful Catholics in America, directed millions of dollars to the church, even as allegations and rumours surfaced for decades. The 400-page report lays most of the blame on John Paul II, now a saint, whose friendship with McCarrick dated back to the 1970s. In 2000, he appointed McCarrick to the helm of the church in Washington, D.C., despite knowing of reports that he'd shared a bed with seminarians at a beach house. The report concludes that Pope John Paul II ultimately chose to believe McCarrick's denial of those allegations. James Grine claims McCarrick abused him for two decades, starting as a child in the 1960s.
While the report itself is powerful, the abuse to me was incredibly heinous, and it hurts forever.
McCarrick was defrocked by Pope Francis last year amid more allegations.
Both Pope Benedict and Pope Francis emerged largely unscathed by this report, but it raises tough questions for the church and accountability for US bishops when they meet next week. Lindsay?
Ian, our thanks to you. And now to the race for control of the U.S. Senate. North Carolina Democrat Cal Cunningham conceded to Republican Senator Tom Tillis today, leaving the balance of power in the Senate at 49 Republicans and 48 Democrats. Regardless of what happens with the Senate race in Alaska, where the state just began counting its absentee ballots today, the balance of power in the Senate now runs through Georgia's two runoffs in January. Our Steve Osunsami reports in from Atlanta.
It's looking very likely tonight that control of the U.S. Senate will lie in the hands of Georgia voters on January 5th, when four candidates who are unable to win a majority in the election will try to punch their ticket to Washington. These seats have been held by Republicans for the better part of two decades, but Democrats Raphael Warnock and John Ossoff think that they can make history here.
I think that these incumbent Republican senators just felt entitled to an easy dance back to victory.
Conventional wisdom says the Democrats shouldn't win, that they do poorly in runoffs here. But Joe Biden is proving that things change, holding on to a lead in a state that President Obama lost twice. Sitting Senators David Perdue and Kelly Loeffler are trying to beat the Democrats.
In January, I have one of the most radical opponents on the Democrat ticket.
At the same time, they're calling for the resignation of one of their own, Georgia's Republican Secretary of State, who ran the election and says he's not going anywhere.
Steve Osunsami joins us now. And Steve, tonight many Georgia Republicans are demanding a full hand recount. But let's be clear here, there's been no evidence presented of any big fraud. So what impact would a recount have?
Well, just like you said, the lieutenant governor of Georgia has come out saying that he doesn't believe that there's any widespread fraud. And of course, the secretary of state has said that he doesn't believe that there was widespread fraud, and certainly nothing in his opinion that would hand a victory to the president. And both of these men are Republicans. This has divided the Republican Party in this state. There are people who are taking the president's side, and then some who are basically saying that this was a good election run by Republicans. In terms of what difference it could make, it depends on who you ask. The people asking for a recount believe or assert that there was enough impropriety to make a difference of thousands upon thousands of votes. But the Secretary of State, who's seeing those numbers firsthand and is aware of whatever issues are being alleged, said that he doesn't think it's going to make a difference. So it's looking like it's unclear it will make a difference, but we just don't know for sure just yet.
And Steve, we're getting word tonight that the vice president plans to campaign in Georgia. This likely won't be the last top official for either party who swings through these next couple of months.
No, we expect to be having sort of a political barbecue here for the next few weeks because, I would expect to see all of the top officials. And you and I have talked about this privately. It would be smart on the part of Democrats, especially, to bring the president-elect down here to campaign for these two candidates because, we all know, of course, this is looking like the hands of the Senate, the control of the Senate will be decided by these races, and we're expecting a long, drawn-out election season all the way up until January 5th, which means that even during the Christmas season, people who are tired, sick and tired of these political ads are going to have to bear through them on their televisions and devices.
But Steve, if I can just really quickly, you think that it benefits the Republicans if this becomes truly the national race that many expect?
It's hard to say. I think that if you look at the history of runoff elections here in Georgia, they don't tend to favor Democrats. It seems to be a little harder for Democrats to get their voters out in these runoff elections. We've seen a number of cases where a Democrat who was even ahead in the first election ended up losing badly in the runoff because it's hard to get people to come out. But all of the conventional wisdom that sort of applies to Georgia politics seems to have been thrown out the window a little bit with Joe Biden leading the polls here by a fairly significant margin in a state that everyone thought was red.
Steve Osunsami, our thanks to you. Georgia being poised to flip blue for the first time since 1992 is likely because of the hard work of organizations like the New Georgia Project and their commitment to registering voters. Joining us now is New Georgia Project CEO Inse Ulfat. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hi, thank you for having me.
So your organization registered more than 400,000 voters for this election, and that certainly contributed to only 2% of eligible Georgia residents not being registered to vote. What's your plan to get all these voters to turn out again in January? And do you believe that the success in Georgia is because of these new voters or Republicans switching to vote for Joe Biden?
So we've been very clear from the beginning that electoral outcomes in Georgia are determined by one, who shows up to vote, and two, whose votes count or get counted. And many people know that Georgia has a long and a recent history of voter suppression. And so, A, registering voters and making sure that people understand the opportunity and how powerful their vote is, particularly in this moment. And then B, making sure that we do everything that we possibly can to make sure that their votes are counted, that we're able to neutralize and mute the voter suppression tactic that we've seen over the past couple of years. And so I maintain that there was not a lot of ideological shift, that it was the battle of the bases. Who shows up?
You just had more boots on the ground and going actually on election day or also filling out the early ballots as your contention. So as you know, youth voters contributed 21% of Georgia's votes, the highest percentage of youth voters in the entire country. Actually turn out. What was it about this time that worked?
Well, we understood why, right? So it's not that there's not anything about their youth. It's lack of familiarity with the process. It's how we talk about voting. It's the extraordinary hurdles that are placed that people have to clear in order to participate in our process. So we spent a lot of time, and again, not in October, but throughout the year, demystifying the process, giving people the game, giving young people the game, as my staff like to say, but also, you know, thinking about doing civic engagement differently. We had a live stream on the front page of Twitch, which is the streaming platform that gamers prefer, that had 500,000 unique viewers on election day. And so thinking about meeting people where they are, demystifying the process, and helping folks remove barriers, and then understanding the power of their vote.
So you say giving young people the game. I'm curious, give me like the 15-second version of what is it that you say to compel a young voter to go out to the polls?
Well, if you are serious about defund the police, then you need to understand that mayors and city councils are the ones who set police budgets. And so while like voting for president is actually really important, voting for mayor and city council is super important if this is your issue. Right. And the reason that that came up is because we spent this summer in the street registering young people who had been radicalized by instances where Black folks, particularly, but young Black people were being murdered. There was a summer of racial justice protest, an uprising, if you will. And we knew that, that many of the young people who were showing up and protesting and demonstrating for the first time were not registered to vote. And so we showed up to meet them there. And we went to have conversations because initially some of the responses were, you know, why does voting matter? My vote won't matter. The parties are the same, et cetera. And some of the like rhetoric that you often hear from young people about the political process. And so we met them there. We engaged them to have real conversations about the change that they want to see and how to actually bring that change to light.
Now, Georgia has certainly been plagued with voter suppression accusations for years. How would you say that this election went, and what is your response to Republicans who are claiming without evidence that there have been widespread allegations of voter irregularities, issues with voting machines and poll watcher access?
Well, you just said it, without evidence. And so I think that it's important when we are teaching young people and new Americans about misinformation and disinformation, like there are a couple of things that we, you know, encourage and teach people to interrogate. So we don't want to be, you know, unwitting amplifiers of misinformation and disinformation when we know that there is not any evidence. And let's be clear, there's no one in Georgia who was looking for voter suppression or voter fraud more than our sort of ecosystem of democracy defenders and civil rights and voting rights activists. We had up to 4,500 volunteers throughout early voting and on election day, and there's simply no evidence of it. And so I refuse to treat it like that's credible.
Now, you've been at the helm of New Georgia Project for 7 years now. Are there specific inflection points these past 7 years that have helped your organization register voters? And do you believe, if the state does in fact go blue, that this is a lasting coalition and not just a blip on the radar?
Absolutely. I think that Georgia state legislators refusing over and over and over again to expand Medicare, and people realizing how cruel it is, particularly at a time where, you know, 80% of the people who've been hospitalized due to COVID are people of color, half the people who died are people of color, and that COVID-related illnesses and deaths and the contraction rate are on the rise, and most Georgians still don't have access to quality, affordable healthcare, is a particular kind of meanness, evil that folks are realizing and having to contend with in this moment of quarantine. And because we've been having millions of conversations with Georgians each year, folks are recognizing that the one thing that we can do, one of the easiest things that we can do to bring about that particular change, is to change the people in the state legislature who claim to be doing work in our interest and in the interest of our families. But many Georgians, again, find themselves, we had a president who was telling us to drink bleach, a governor who refused to shut down the state until he absolutely didn't have any choice. And Georgia was one of the first states, if not the first state, to open up early. And again, we are continuing to see death. So the life and death, the stakes feel very high in this particular election. And again, I think that people, there's a recognition that voting and voting to elect champions, or at least elect people who don't do harm to our communities, is one of the easiest things that we can do to protect ourselves.
Insay, do you think that the political future is in the cards for you?
Me? No, I'm an organizer. Listen, I'm a person of the people. I love the idea that what we do is based out of love, right? Love for ourselves, love for our families, love for our communities. And I want to work with people to build power so that we can win and then defend those wins beyond one election cycle. And running for office is hard.
And so is organizing.
Organizing gets the goods.
All right. Insay Ufa from the New Georgia Project, our thanks to you for your time.
Thank you.
A lot of our reality has certainly mimicked the Jetsons cartoon with its futuristic flair. So for a long time, we thought the next step in travel technology would be flying cars. But it's clear the real future of travel is all about the loop, the Hyperloop, as it's being called. And our Clayton Sandell caught up with the first two humans to give it a whirl.
20 miles outside Las Vegas, Nevada, in this tube running through a dusty desert, a cutting-edge technology and two people inside it just made history.
3, 2, 1, launch.
Josh Geigel and Sara Lukian just became the first humans to ride in something called the Virgin Hyperloop.
That was so good!
What kind of looks like a ride on Space Mountain is actually a type of futuristic transportation for most of us, unless you live in the fictional country of Wakanda.
That's magnetic levitation, right?
Obviously.
Maglev train tech has been around for decades, but the Hyperloop supercharges it.
Imagine traveling nonstop at up to 670 miles per hour, above land or underground. This is Hyperloop.
It works by putting the passenger capsule inside a sealed tube.
Hyperloop One's unique technology uses magnetic levitation to guide and lift the pod off the track. Nearly all of the air inside the Hyperloop tube is removed using a series of vacuum pumps. This effectively creates our own sky inside the tube, as if you were quietly flying at 200,000 feet above sea level. This reduces drag so only the smallest amount of electricity is needed to achieve extraordinary speeds.
The company says the Hyperloop would drastically cut the travel time between cities from hours to minutes.
From Los Angeles, Las Vegas, you're looking somewhere between about 30, 40 minutes. Top speed on that might be in excess of about 500 miles an hour. You get up to speed, you get straight from downtown Los Angeles to downtown Las Vegas, and something that you could pop over for lunch, pop over for a quick gamble.
Or a show.
Or a show.
Geigel, the company's chief technology officer, and Luke Yan, the director of passenger experience, were the willing guinea pigs.
It's a bit like an aircraft taking off on the runway. We went fairly fast. So the last test, we went about 107 miles an hour. The biggest thing that you noticed is Sarah and I didn't walk into the vehicle in spacesuits.
We're not astronauts.
We're not astronauts. We walked in and closed like this. We got in, we sat down, and most importantly, we got out.
The company also has to convince future customers they are safe, confined in a sealed tube at high speeds, with occasional noise and shaking. Sound familiar?
People are already traveling in an enclosed vehicle in a low-pressure environment at very high speed, and those are airplanes.
The purpose of this test was really, if it's not safe for me, it's not safe for Sarah, it's not safe for anyone else.
The space age idea of traveling by tube has been around at least since the Jetsons.
You call, sir!
Today's technology still needs more testing and development, government approvals, and lots of money. But if everything stays on track or floating just above it, it may not be long before several competing companies are offering tickets to ride all over the world.
Whether it be in India, whether it be in Europe, or even in the Middle East, I think there's a huge opportunity for multiple systems to be up and running by the end of the decade, and that's certainly what we're going after.
Virgin says once it can go from 2 passengers a day to, say, 20,000, running faster and cleaner than commercial airliners, Hyperloop technology might fundamentally change life as we know it.
We're talking about a technology that can connect cities as if they were metro stops, and that has tremendous implications for where you choose to live, where you choose to work, where you get your education or your health care. And we're really thinking about the ways that we can inspire ourselves and others during what's been a very difficult year. We're doing it. We're making progress, despite everything, towards a better future, a greener, cleaner, more connected world.
And that would make even George Jetson proud. Clayton Sandell, ABC News Live, Denver.
Cutting technology there, our thanks to Clayton. And when we return, how the country music world has persisted during this pandemic.
The world may feel out of your control, but your happiness doesn't have to be. Learn the secrets to happiness. Listen to the 10% Happier podcast, free on Apple Podcasts.
ABC News, honored winner of 4 Edward R. Murrow Awards, including the most prestigious honor, overall excellence in television. ABC News, America's number one news choice.
This is what being live is all about. This is ABC News Live, the 24/7 streaming news source from ABC News. Breaking news, live events, streaming nonstop. Original breakthrough storytelling from ABC News, National Geographic, ESPN, and it's all designed differently for you to stream straight to any screen whenever you want.
ABC News Live.
Streaming everywhere, right to you.
ABC News Live. It's that easy to go there.
ABC News, America's number one news source. Straightforward news, straight to the heart of the story. ABC News, straightforward.
It's been 4 days since Joe Biden was projected president-elect, yet still no acknowledgement from President Trump that he's lost. Instead, he's been uncharacteristically out of the public eye as Joe Biden prepares to leave the country. Meanwhile, the Trump team and most Republicans in Congress remain defiant. The president's campaign has also filed numerous lawsuits, but federal and state judges have found no evidence of voter fraud.
It's not unusual. Should not be alarming.
And in another sign, Republicans and the current White House are refusing to accept reality. There's this from Secretary of State Mike Pompeo.
There will be a smooth transition to a second Trump administration.
The General Services Administration, which facilitates the transition of any new president, also refusing to recognize Biden's victory, withholding crucial transition resources.
I'm confident that the fact that they're not willing to acknowledge we won at this point is not of much consequence in our planning and what we're able to do between now and January 20th.
country with those grim firsts. 165,000 daily COVID cases and rising cases in all 50 states.
El Paso, Texas hospitals are so full that the state shipped in med-surge tents and a 10th mobile morgue.
The trajectory does not look good at all, and that to me is extremely scary.
But some help is on the way as the FDA authorized use of a monoclonal antibody treatment used for mild to moderate cases. And drug maker Pfizer announced that early results show their vaccine could be 90% effective.
Russia brokers a peace deal between Armenia and Azerbaijan.
Russian peacekeepers are already arriving in Nagorno-Karabakh to enforce the deal brokered by Russia between Armenia and Azerbaijan to end the war there. The deal sees Azerbaijan keep key parts of Nagorno-Karabakh that it has seized in the six-week war, and Armenia will also pull back from some other areas. Violent protests have erupted in Armenia's capital, denouncing the deal as a surrender and demanding that Prime Minister Nikol Pashinyan resign. Armenia's leaders, though, have said they had no choice but to agree in the face of major Azerbaijani advances.
And a massive iceberg is on a collision course with South Georgia Island off the southern tip of South America. The iceberg, which cut loose 3 years ago from Antarctica, is just about as big as the island itself. Experts say if it grinds into the island, it could be stuck there for a decade.
Lockdown is the word of the year. Collins English Dictionary says it registered over a quarter of a million usages of lockdown during 2020, up from 4,000 in 2019. Other pandemic-related words such as coronavirus, social distancing, and self-isolate were on the dictionary's list of the top 10 words. The abbreviation BLM for Black Lives Matter also made the shortlist.
Okay, so if you're cooking Thanksgiving dinner this year, you can now ensure your meal in case things don't turn out as planned. Whole Foods and Progressive came up with this offer. They say the pandemic is forcing many families to host smaller gatherings this year, sometimes forcing an inexperienced cook to take over.
And we'll help take care of any Thanksgiving slip-ups, so you can have the confidence to try some of my favorite techniques, like turkactin and a duckin.
Well, buyers will get a $35 gift card to Whole Foods for a, quote, turkey cooking fail. The promotion is limited to 1,000 customers.
Finally tonight, the pandemic has created havoc across the entertainment industry. Here in New York, it shut down Broadway, all those theaters empty and actors now out of work. The same can be said in Nashville, where the lights have gone dark in many of that city's popular country music venues. But like we have seen in so many places, desperation has turned to resilience. Here's ABC's special contributor, Jake Owen.
8 months ago, we watched as the honky-tonks on Nashville's Broadway went dark. Arenas shuttered indefinitely as stay-at-home orders were given in cities across the country. And the knocks of aspiring artists on Music Row's doors faded away.
That I thought we'd never make it through.
Yet, despite the uncertainty at the time, the country music community kept the music on as we waded through the darkest days of the pandemic. Fans rallied around artists as they released new music fit for the times.
There will be light after dawn, someday when we aren't 6 feet apart.
Like the soulful ballad, 6 Feet Apart by Luke Combs, about coping in the pandemic.
Homesick.
Or Kane Brown's Homesick remix that benefited veterans and frontline workers.
It's like half of me.
Artists even dropped into Zooms and FaceTimes to surprise our incredible healthcare heroes. Brad Paisley enlisted his fans and famous friends to make a socially distant music video for his song No Eye in Beer, bringing people together from all over the world.
We're on a mission to help those struggling with hunger and food insecurity.
And in the true spirit of the country music community, Brad and his wife, Kimberly Williams Paisley, personally donated over 1 million meals with Feeding America to help food insecure families all over the country.
There's a place I know about.
Paisley recently joined Carrie Underwood at the Grand Ole Opry and reflected on the resiliency of the country community.
As long as the Opry keeps going, I have hope. It gives me hope for our lives in Nashville, for country music in general, and good job, Grand Ole Opry, keeping going.
When it rains, it pours.
And in perhaps the most fitting way, Kacey Musgraves' song Rainbow, originally released in 2019, found a new life as a comforting anthem for anyone struggling throughout these last 8 months. The lyrics hitting home as so many families hung rainbow drawings in their windows, a sign of unity as the death toll from COVID-19 continued to climb. When Kacey performed the song for the benefit concert, One World at Home Together, she sang the final line looking into the camera and giving hope to so many watching at home.
Our thanks to Jake Owen for that, and be sure to tune in tomorrow night at 7 p.m. here on ABC News Live for our special one-hour live preview from the CMA Awards. Lara Spencer will co-host from the red carpet at Music City Center. Prime will air right after at 8 o'clock, then 9 and 11, as usual. And before we go tonight, our image of the day, a golf shot that you have to see to believe. In the practice rounds of the Masters, look at that, golfer John Rahm skipping his way over the water to a hole in one on his birthday, no less. Look at this, it rolls right on in after walking on water, that hop, skip, and jump over the water, and then he sinks it in. Look at that, happy birthday to John. And that is our show for this hour. Be sure to stay tuned to ABC News Live for more context and analysis of the day's top stories. I'm Lindsay Davis. Thanks so much for streaming with us, and good night.